Namaste, guys. Namaste, girls. Namaste, everybody. Namaste, back rows. Good. You're all awake. Middle? Okay. How many of you are here from outside Kerala? Can I have a show of hands? Good. Nice. Okay. Very good. How many of you from outside South India? That is basically not from Tamil Nadu, Karnataka, Kerala or Andhra. Okay. How many of you from Andhra? Okay. How many of you from Assam? How many of you from Arunachal Pradesh? Himachal? Kashmir? Rajasthan? Good. Ranchi? Wow. Good. Uttarakhand? Punjab? Wonderful. How many of you are on your first trip to Kerala? Okay. First visit to Kerala. Okay. Very good. It's wonderful to talk to all of you. It's wonderful to have, to be given an opportunity to interact with bright, young, cheerful, smiling faces from across the country. And it's a very nice setup that AYUDH has. It's not AYUDH, it's AYUDH. We always mispronounce it saying AYUDH. AYUDH is no war, AYUDH, right? It's Amrita, Yuva, Dharma, Dhara, but also AYUDH means no war. AYUDH means weapon, it completely changes the meaning. So I should not mispronounce it. So today you've been having fun till now? No, they haven't had fun, I think. You've been having fun till now? Back rows, middle rows? Yes? Yes? Good. So you've been having fun and you've been having a nice time. But I'm going to take some time to spoil your mood. I'm sorry, I'm going to tell you something serious. Because you're here on this leadership summit, correct? AYUDH Leaders Training Summit. You want to be leaders. And to be leaders, you have to know certain things. What is a leader? The one who leads his companion. How do you lead? Okay, your name is what? AYUDH. AYUDH, how do you lead your companions? You should be a good. I would listen to all of them. Okay, okay, okay. Hold on. AYUDH, you said you should be a good speaker, but you should listen to all of them. No, so you should be a good listener. That first. You should be a good listener. Then? Huh? Be what? Strategic and decisive. Whoa, wow, okay. You should motivate everyone. Then? Confidence. Then clap. Wonderful. AYUDH. Hey, what is your name? Huh? Akash. Oh, we are going very strong on the A's now. AYUDH and Akash. Yeah. You should. Positivity. Positivity means you should lose some electrons. No. Okay. Okay, what is positive? How many of you are science students, by the way? Okay. How many of you are economics, commerce students? Good. Okay. Okay. How many of you are acoustic students? Who make sound? All of you. Okay. Now, so good. I'm going to talk a little bit. I'm going to talk both. I'm going to talk both economics. I'm going to talk science. I'm going to talk Amma. I'm going to talk you. I'm going to talk me. Yeah. So you said positivity, listening, communication, confidence, strategic decisions and, strategic what? Akash, my God, you should be giving the speech here, not me. What? Being strategic and decisive. Motivating. And always have an aim to win. No. When you have aim to win, what do you mean by that?
To be on the lead, but with some positivity, not with negativity.
Okay.
Not to be egoistic,
but still to be a winner. That combination is very difficult, kids. That combination is not so easy. And that is how you be a leader. First step to be a leader, you know, is what? is to be a follower. Do you know what Swami Vivekananda says? Sit down. No need to stand up. You know what Swami Vivekananda says about the person who's the ideal leader? The ideal servant is the ideal leader. A leader is someone who suffers with the sufferings that others suffer, who understands the problems experientially, not theoretically. Not someone who just sits in his 5-star bungalow and gives some talk, like our politicians. But people who go into the world, not like someone above giving like this, no. People who mix, go down, help from grassroots up, without asking for what? Without being selfish, without having a selfish aim, without asking for remuneration, without asking for this or that. The moment you say, I have sinned, many Amrita students are into IAS now. I always ask them, why do you want to do IAS? Indian Administrative Service. How many of you want to be in IAS? Good, our strategic decision maker. Good, I hope so. I hope you get into IAS. But I'll tell you the problems. And many people say, one fellow actually told me, some people give wonderful answers, and I want to serve India, I want to, you know, make new policies, I want to make the village life better. So many people have told me those things. One fellow was very frank. He said, sir, I like to ride horses in Simla. I said, what? Apparently for IAS, you have a training and they take you to Simla and you ride horses, and then you have parties where you drink all sorts of things along with the Coca-Cola, and then he wants the good life. I said, you don't have to be in IAS to have the good life. You can, well, that's not the motive. But anyway, there's something I want to tell you about what every Indian should know. Every one of you should know, and every one of you should feel it. There is a difference between knowing and feeling. There is a difference between theoretically understanding something, reading it in a paper, and between taking it into yourself and it penetrating into your mind and your heart and your blood and your veins, and should prevent you from sleeping. A leader is one who lives for a cause, who has a passion, who goes for it. That cause will prevent him or her from sleeping. It should be an all-consuming passion. And until then, unless you identify an ideal in your life for which you are able to give your all, which prevents you from sleeping, which prevents you from thinking of anything else, which makes you sacrifice each and every personal consideration in order to achieve that. Until and unless you bite that bullet, you won't be a leader. It's not about attending talks. It's not about going to camps. It's not about riding horses in Simla. It's not about getting your name in the headlines. No, that's not being a leader. A leader is one who's consumed by a fire. Now look at this slide. This slide talks about a scientist. A scientist who's also, I don't know if the back screens are working, sir. No, sir. Back screens are working. I'm reading the slide. It's a scientist come lawyer in New York, Gustav Smith. See what he says. See, today we have all sorts of problems in this world. All sorts of problems never heard of before. At this extent, we have, of course, overpopulation, we have climate change, we have global warming, we have pollution, we have corruption, we have poverty, we have terrorism, we have strange new diseases, we have health problems, we have, you name it. Every problem that man has had to face has come to a crisis point. And we are right there now. So this is what he's talking about. He says, I used to think the top problems were biodiversity, loss, ecosystem collapse, and climate change. I thought with 30 years of good science, we could address these problems. Now, this is a scientist who's talking, okay? He's Gus Smith. Check him up on Google. He's environmental lawyer, scientist, New York. Okay. I thought that with 30 years of good science, we could address these problems, but I was wrong. The top problems are selfishness, greed, and apathy. Not pollution, not lack of resources, not lack of technology, or a missing formula, or a missing link, or a new genetic revolution, or the new gene to be discovered. That's not what it is. Those are good, of course. The new material that you're going to make, or the new gene that you're going to discover in your battle against cancer, or the new polymer you're going to make, or the new radar system you're going to develop, good. But that's not the problem. The problem that we face today, the chief problems are selfishness, greed, and apathy. And to deal with that, we need a spiritual transformation, not a scientific one. And that's where our mainstream education pathetically fails today. I've been there, I'm telling you. I've been a student for more than you have been alive. Yeah, I finished my PhD when I was 30 years old. So you are how old now? 17, yeah. So I've been a student for more than you have been alive. And I've been a teacher, not for so long, but still. Yeah, I'm not too old. Don't worry about my hair, okay? I'm actually as young as all of you, okay? That's a joke, and you're supposed to laugh when I crack a joke, otherwise you don't get a chocolate, okay? Okay? Now, coming back seriously, these are the chief problems we face today. Selfishness, greed, and apathy. Apathy means what? Who cares? Attitude. That is called apathy. Hey, chalega. That's apathy. Who cares? Attitude is apathy. Selfishness, greed, and apathy. That's the problem. You know something? Yesterday we came across a very beautiful, cheerful news that criminals who had duped the country for how much crores is that? I forgot the number of zeros. I don't know how to count so big. 17 lakh crores, right? Went scot-free. Do you know something? According to latest reports, the amount of black money, okay, the amount of black money kept in Swiss banks by our wonderful and beautiful leaders, our so-called leaders, okay, leaders it seems, my foot, okay, if I could see half of them, I would give them a thrashing, which they won't forget. But our so-called leaders, okay, for the past 60 years, the amount of black money kept in Swiss banks, you know how much is it? 1,700, I'll tell you, probably more than that, okay? But this is a kind of ballpark number. 1,700 billion, okay? B for Bala, my name is Bala. $1,700 billion, okay? Can you even imagine that amount, that's the amount of black money kept? That's the amount of black money that was siphoned out of India. Who does it belong to? Who does that money belong to? To you? Well, it belongs to Vijay Mallya. Probably a sizable chunk of it. No, but anyway, I'm not talking politics. Guys, I am not talking politics. I don't favor any politician. I don't belong to any party. I belong to truth and to love because I belong to Amma. Okay? I don't belong to any politics. Okay. Now, yes, I proudly say that. I belong to Amma. And I'll tell you, I'll tell you a little bit more later on. But then $1,700 billion. How much is that? So 1 million is 10 power 6, right? 1 billion is 1,000 million. So 1,700 into 10 to the power of 6 into 10 to the power of 3. So 1,700 into 10 power 9 dollars. Dollars, okay? US dollars. Okay, good. 1,700 into 10 power 9. So 1,700 is what? 1.7 into 10 power 3. 1.7 into 10 to the power of 3 into 10 to the power of 9. How much is that? 1.7 into 10 to the power of 12. It's like Avogadro's number. 6.023 in 10 power 23 molecules. 1 mole of rupees, you know. It's like that. Okay. How much is that again? 1.7 into 10 to the power of 12 dollars. Not rupees, dollars. US dollars. Now, how much is a US dollar to the rupee? 65. Let's assume 70, okay? Now it's around 67. Okay, sure. 60. Fine. You want 60 or 70? 67. Oh, you trade in dollars or something? Oh, you know, 67. No, let's assume 70, okay? So that's 1.7 into 10 to the power of 12 into 70. So 1.7 into 7 is how much? 11.9, correct? Am I right? 11.9. So 11.9 into 10 to the power of 13 rupees. Imagine that if you put 1 rupee at a time and stack up 10 power 13 rupees, assuming 1 rupee is how much thick? 0.5 centimeter or maybe millimeter? 10 power 13 millimeters, you will cross the moon. Yeah, you'll cross the moon. Yeah? Have you thought about it? So 11.9 into 10 to the power of 13 rupees. What an astronomical number. In India, there are about 400 million under poverty line. Okay? There are 400 million under poverty line. By that, what do I mean by poverty? Not that, when I talk about poor people, I am not talking about people who find it difficult to send their children to IITs. I'm not talking about people who, you know, eat a meager meal at home and are not able to, you know, go to a fancy restaurant and eat. No. I'm talking about people who don't have a home. I'm talking about people who don't have even that food. I'm talking about people who don't have money to buy a painkiller to ease their pain. That's what I'm talking about. I'm talking about people writhing in agony, rolling on the ground, holding their head or their stomach, screaming in pain because they don't have 25 rupees to buy a painkiller. Until and unless you go to a hospital, see people like that suffering, you will never know what it is, what it takes to serve them. You have to know that. You have to see that. Don't think by switching the TV channel, we see it in TV, oh, how terrible, and we switch the remote, and then we go to the next channel. That's apathy. That's apathy. You can't switch the TV remote to feel more comfortable. You just can't put it down. So when Amma was a kid, she went to a nearby hospital. And those days, I'm talking about 50 years ago, to buy a prescription or something like that, you need to write something on a piece of paper and put it in a government hospital. The paper used to cost 1 paise. Okay? The paper used to cost 1 paise. And she says she saw some old ladies who didn't have that 1 paise to buy the paper to write the medicine on. And they were rolling on the ground in pain. And then she ran home. Amma as a kid ran home, took some money, took some stuff, came running back to the hospital, gave it to her. How many people are there like that in India? 400 million people are under poverty line. Now, 11.9 into 10 to the power of 13 rupees, you divide by this 400. You and I don't want this money, that's fine. We are extremely rich and wealthy compared to these people. First, understand that. We have loving parents, we have an education, we are sitting in a hall, we have two hands, two legs, good health. My good God, we are blessed. There are 400 million people today who don't know where the next meal will come from. And yet, we have 11.9 into 10 to the power of 13 rupees, which belongs to them, sitting somewhere. So if you divide 11.9 into 10 power 13, divide it by 400 million. 4 into 10 power 6 into 100. 4 into 10 power 8. Right? 10 power 13 by 10 power 8 is how much? 10 power 5. 1 lakh per person into 11.9. Forget the 11.9, okay? 11 by 4 is how much? 12 by 4, right? 11.9 by 4. 3 lakhs per person. You're looking 3 lakhs per person. Of course, you can say if you directly bring that money in, you can't give it inflation, blah, 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 all that stuff you will say. That's fine. But that was originally meant for national development, na? That 11.9, 10 per 13 rupees, right?
That could have been used towards this. 3 lakhs per person. There is no need. India would not have been a poor country. India would have been a superpower by now. There would not be a single person hungry in this country. We would have been the world's richest and most successful country. What did we lack that caused this? Of course, we lack leadership. But what did we really lack? We lacked values. We lacked dharma. Right? Corruption, dishonesty, selfishness, greed, not thinking about others, searching only for personal motive. What is in it for me? What is in it for me? That's it. My country, my needs, my family's needs, my community's needs, my language people's needs, my state's needs, my caste needs. Yes, you name it, every possible division. Who thinks of India's needs? That's why we are in this state today. Because of this. It's not because of lack of resources or lack of brains. Don't let them tell you that. Not at all. You guys are some of the most brilliant people on earth. You go to Silicon Valley. I lived there for several years. Every company there, half the PhDs are Indians. Half the CEOs are Indians. Yeah, who's the CEO of Google? Who's the CEO of Microsoft? Who's the CEO of Pepsi? That lady, no? Some Indians. You know, near my house in the Silicon Valley, there is, half of California runs on Indian brains. If half the Indians come back, USA will crash. Have you heard of Silicon Valley? You've heard of Intel? Intel inside. How many of you have laptops? Okay. How many of you use computers? All of you, right? Intel processor, exactly. It's full of Indians. Don't say Indians don't. Indians are some of the most intelligent people to walk on earth. See? Yes. Don't clap too soon. Don't clap too soon. You're not going to like my next sentence. Indians are some of the most intelligent people to walk on earth. But Indians are also, unfortunately, some of the most dishonest people to walk on earth. I have to say that. I'm sorry. You know what Winston Churchill said? You know there was a fellow called Winston Churchill. You know? Yeah. The UK Prime Minister in the time of the war. He said the problems, okay, that's a big story, we won't go there. He said the problem with you Indians is you're very selfish. You don't think of your country first. That's true. You know, in the US, when several of us worked there, I have many friends there. Before I returned to India, 10 years ago, 11 years ago, I returned here. Many of my friends, some family members also, they asked me, why are you returning to India? They asked me this question. Why are you returning to India? Where do you want to go back? You see, in the US, there are a lot of Chinese, Vietnamese, Mexicans, of course, naturally Americans, Europeans, right? Japanese, Koreans. They come there, they learn, they go back to their countries. Some of them stay on. Many of them go back and they help build their own countries, right? Japan was devastated by the Second World War, right? Atom bombs laid waste Japan, but yet it blossomed into such a country because of patriotism. When the tsunami came in Japan, see, these are hard facts we should know. When the tsunami came in Japan, you see, there was a tsunami refugee camp. You know that, right? On March 2011, tsunami hit Japan. There was a refugee camp, and people give out some towels and soap and all that for the survivors. They come in a single line. They will take one towel or soap. They will see how many people are behind them. If there are more, they won't take even more than one. And they will bow down, they take, and they bow down, and they go away. You try opening camps like that in India. Open a bag of towels and soaps. Before you turn, it's all gone. And the survivors won't get anything. So, why do you return to India, they asked. No Japanese asked me this question, why you return to India. No Korean asked me this question. Okay? No American asked me the question. No European asked me the question. Why you return to your country? Only this Indian comes and asks. Hey, why are you returning to India? I feel like slapping him. Why can't I return to my country? Why didn't you return? That's my question to him. What's wrong in coming back to my country and serving my country? That seems so strange. That seems so crazy. Hey, your house is in trouble. What's wrong in going to build it? You understand? Why has this lack of patriotism and lack of national pride come into us? That's the question. That's the question we have to ask. That's the question you have to ask each and one of us. What am I going to do for my country? That's the first question you have to ask. On the resumes you have, no? Objective. If you see people, in another couple of years, you will be applying for jobs and all that. You'll say objective to become a leader in an organization, this, that, everything. Right? Have you written a resume? Have you written a mock resume in your classes? Have you? Your objective, you write. What am I going to, what? To become a successful engineer, entrepreneur, to join an organization, this, that is objective written in your resume. But in your mind's resume, what needs to be written is, to do the best for my country. What am I going to do for India? That's a question. That is a question that should be there uppermost in our minds. Yes? That's a big difference. So Winston Churchill actually said that. You Indians lack patriotism. We do. Look at the amount of black money and all that stuff. In Karnataka, there was one mining minister. I don't know his name. Once again, I told you, I don't belong to any party. He was a mining minister, gold mine minister. They found 35 kilograms of gold in his house. Okay, the bathroom was out of gold. The tap was on gold. The bathtub is out of gold. How do you take a bath in a gold? I mean, but anyway, the commode is out of gold. There is more gold in his house than in the mine. That's kind of corruption that is there. You know, I'll give you one more example and I will tell you one story. I'll give an example. Many of the Amrita kids here know this example already. I've told them this story. But I'm going to repeat it anyway. So, in 2001, January 26, what's January 26? Oh, very good. January 26, 2001, what happened? Constitution was formed in 2001? Huh, then. January 26, 2001, what happened? You were born that time? Not yet. How many of you born in 2001? Born after 2001? Before 2001? Come on. Okay, you are too young. Too young. Okay. Earthquake, exactly. Bhuj. Gujarat, a massive earthquake happened. It flattened out Bhuj and several villages. Its tremors could be felt as far as in South India. I know I was asleep in my house in Bangalore, morning around 8 o'clock or whatever, right? And my bed was shaking. I thought my mom was trying to wake me up desperately. But then I found my mom was not there and the actual bed was shaking by itself and the building was shaking and then I realized it's an earthquake. But Bangalore didn't have the earthquake. The earthquake was in Gujarat and tremors were felt even here in Kerala. Entire villages were flattened, okay? In Ahmedabad, many buildings fell down, okay? But the interesting thing is, among the buildings that fell down, some of them cracked, some of them got broken, etc., etc., etc. But the interesting thing is, among the buildings that fell down, the percentage of new buildings that fell down, okay? Listen to me. The percentage of new buildings that fell down or cracked was more than the percentage of old buildings that fell down or cracked. And that's very strange. Buildings built in 60s, 70s, 80s, even in early 90s stood. Buildings built after 95, 96, 97 cracked and fell. You all agree that engineering has improved, right, over the years? Yes? Civil engineering has improved over the years. Technology has improved over the years. The number of engineers have improved over the years. Huh? We have software now designing the entire building sitting on my chair. I can design the whole building. Materials have improved. Everything has improved.
Then why is it that more new buildings fell down than old? Corruption. What happened is, huh? No, I don't want to say that. I don't want to, well, there are many reasons for it. You see, I just said that actually, we Indians are dishonest, I said like that. But I didn't mean it in that way. The reason behind that dishonesty is thousands of years of poverty and suffering and invasion. A lot of things going behind it. We can't blame anybody, but yet we should see what the mistake is and we should correct it. So that's important. Anyways, yeah, due to corruption. See, I'm a minister, okay? Or rather, okay, I'm not a minister, let's say. I'm an engineer, and let's say I did my PhD in MIT, okay? What is MIT? Massachusetts Technology. I got a PhD in civil engineering from MIT. That's an example, okay? I did not go to MIT, don't worry. So, I got a PhD from MIT, and I am the top civil engineer on earth. And I am about to design this building, okay? And hey, what's your name? Sham. Sham is a very honest, sincere guy. I think so. Okay. Sham is an honest, sincere guy, and he has a cement factory. And he is making cement with which I want to buy the cement and make the building. Okay? Right? But then, I have a friend who's a minister, whose nephew runs a cement factory and makes fraudulent bad cement. And that minister comes and tells me, this is a story, okay? Please don't think I don't have any minister friends. Okay, I'm just giving an example. And this minister comes and tells me, Bala, use the cement that my nephew makes. That way I'll get 500 crores, he'll get 500 crores, I'll give you 5 crores. Okay? And out of my greed, my selfishness, and my apathy, I say, yeah, let's do it. And I take 5 crores from him, he gets 500 crores, and I build a building with faulty cement, and tomorrow, the slightest wind, if I blow, it'll fall down. Tomorrow, an earthquake comes, and the building crashes and falls, 400 people die. And suddenly, I'm no longer an engineer, I'm a mass murderer. Yes or no? Yes or no? Yes or no, back rows? And that is the tragedy. What is the use of my MIT education? What is the use of me knowing all the structural bending Euler's formula and this and that and stress and strain? What is the use of all my technological innovation and software and my material education? It all went down the drain, wasted completely, simply because I didn't have values to use my knowledge wisely. Too selfish. That's the problem. That is what you should understand. I'll tell you an opposite story. The person is here in this campus, and if I give the name, he'll kill me, but I will tell you the opposite story. I have a student, one of my very dear students. Nothing to do with me, he's Amma's student. What happened is he got a job somewhere in North India. Okay? Now I'm telling you a real story. That first one was also a real story. My story was just an example. Okay. A student from here, Amma's student, he got a job in North India. And he worked in a company, very middle class fellow, okay, not a rich guy, not a poor guy, simple B.Tech. He just finished, 21 years old, finished his B.Tech. First job in his life, he's gone to North India. And he's working in this company, which is a very famous company. I won't give you the names. Most of us use its products every day. And he was working in that company, a dynamic leader in that company. His co-manager, he had a manager, he had another manager, co-manager, right? His co-manager had a coal factory, exactly like the story I told you, coal factory. And this company uses the coal from that other co-manager's factory. So my student was asked to sign off on the quality of the coal. You understand? He was asked to sign off on the quality of the coal. So he went there and checked. And he said, no, this call is not good enough. I cannot sign off on it. No, I can't. Then the other guy said, no, you better do. So the other guy is a 45-year-old millionaire, right? A big shot. This guy is just a 22-year-old bacha from here, okay? From a simple middle-class family.
first job in his life. Those days very difficult to get jobs also, right? And that guy says, you better sign it. Then he says, I can't. The quality score is not good enough. I cannot say yes. Another guy said, if you don't, he threatened him. If you don't, I'll make you lose your job. Told my story. But that guy didn't realize that he was dealing with an AYUDH kid like you. You know what my student said? He said, you damn well do what you want. I'm not going to sign it. I don't care. His job was in the line. He's not from a rich family. Ordinary middle class family. Ordinary people, just like us, you and me. Ordinary guy. But he had the inner guts and said, get lost. I'm not going to do it. Luckily for him, his manager was a very honest guy. Okay? His direct manager, he's a co-manager. And thinks his manager protected him. That's Amma's grace. And this guy ended up getting the anti-corruption award in his company. Yeah. And the other guy was transferred to Guwahati. I don't know why the corrupt fellows were transferred to Guwahati. That is what happened. Absolute, complete, true story I'm telling you. See? That's what it takes to be a leader. You should stand up and say, get lost. You should have a right for my country. What is right? What is the right thing to do? Should stand up for it. Should have the moral courage to stand up for it. Should have the spine, should have the nerves of steel, like Swami Vivekananda says, to stand up for it. I say, no. Stand up for your principles. That's the first step to being a leader. First step to being a leader is to have the courage of convictions. The second step is to have a compassionate heart and understand what others are suffering from. When you combine these two things, when you have a heart that feels for others, and when you want to serve others, and you combine it with moral courage and rectitude and the spine of steel, should be soft as a flower but hard as a diamond inside. When you combine these two things, then you are a leader. Okay? Yeah. That's what you guys need to do. I'll tell you one more story. Okay, since it's stories and after lunch people like to hear stories. So I'll tell you one more story. And then we will ask some questions and throw chocolates. Okay? How many chocolates do you have? Okay. So, you know, one of Amma's first charitable activities was buying an orphanage on the way to Trivandrum. Okay? I don't know if very few of you are from Kerala, but down south from here, if you go, you go to Trivandrum, right? Which is the capital city of Kerala. On the highway, you will see an orphanage called Paripalli. And that is the first, one of the first charitable activities that Amma started was they wanted to buy the Kali temple. You saw the they want to build the Kali temple, sorry, not buy it. They want to build it. The ashram was about to... You saw the Kali temple in the morning? You went to the ashram, right? Yeah, you saw that building with the chariot and all that? That's a Kali temple. You go inside, there is a statue of Mother Kali there. Okay, that's a Kali temple. So they were going to build... The temple funds had just collected. Amma herself was living in a hut and people were outside on huts. And money had just come to build the Kali temple. When the orphanage people came and told Amma, we don't have money to run this orphanage. Can you help us out? The students, the children are starving. We don't have funds. So the money meant the Kali temple was diverted and for this orphanage, and Amma acquired this orphanage. And then later on, of course, other money came in, and that's how the Kali temple was built. So this orphanage was built. And the orphanage now, it's a Sanskrit secondary, higher secondary school, and the kids there now are doing so well, they get national level prize, state level prizes in, you know, music, panchavadyam, so many different arts are being taught there. Wonderful school, wonderful place. But it was expanding. And the brahmachari, in the ashram you have brahmacharis, you have seen these people in white, okay, who are
there to serve, take part in the various charitable organizations. So the brahmachari in charge of the ash of the orphanage came to Amma and said, Amma, the place is becoming full. We need more space. Can I buy the adjoining land to expand and have one more building? Okay. Can I buy the adjoining land and expand to have one more building? Amma said, yes, go ahead and buy that land. But the owner of that land happened to be an Amma devotee. So he came and asked Amma, Amma, your brahmachari orphanage has to be expanded and he wants to buy that land. Shall I sell it to him? Usually they come and check, right? Because he's also an Amma devotee. So he came to check with Amma. Can I sell the land to him? Amma said, no, don't sell. So the first person she said, buy. To that person she said, don't sell. What to do? Then he went back. The brahmachari said, no, Amma asked me to buy. Then that guy said, yes, but Amma told me not to sell. So he was very puzzled. Okay. Then that was stalemate. So next year, same thing happened. Buy the land. Amma said, yes. The owner of the land came and said, Amma, can I sell the land? Amma said, no. People, that is, what is wrong with this? Something is, what is wrong with this? Then third year came up. The guy came and asked Amma, Amma, can I buy the land? Yes, surely buy it. The owner of the land came and said, Amma, can I sell the land? No. Fourth year, I'm not joking, it's a true story. Fourth year, same story. Fifth year, same story. Sixth year, same story. Seventh year, the guy was fed up. There were so many people had joined the orphanage, the kids had come in, he desperately needed a space. He was getting fed up and he came and told him, Amma, I need the space. Otherwise, they'll have to sit on my head. There's no other place. So, can I buy that land? Amma said, I told you long ago, buy it. Then he said, yeah, right, but you keep telling him not to sell. Then that guy came and said, Amma, can I sell the land? Amma said, sell. Then this guy got so wild. He said, what? Sell? Sell. Sorry, one second. Sell, sell. Amma said, yes, sell it. And the first guy, the brahmachari in charge of the orphanage, got wild. He went to Amma and said, Amma, do you know what you just did? This is prime property. For those of you who know, you see, down the highway, NH-47. It's prime property of NH-47. He said, Amma, do you know what you just did? 7 years ago when I asked you, you told him not to sell. Now you are asking him to sell. Do you know how much the price has increased? He thought, Amma may not know that land prices increase after all. You know, we sometimes become very very wise. We try to give Amma advice. And then we get a nice beating on our ego when we realize what her motives are. Don't you know, Amma, that the land price increases? This much also you don't know. 7 years have passed. Land price has not increased one. It has increased 100 times. If you had bought this 7 years ago, you would have just got it for peanuts. Now you have to spend crores. Don't you understand this? Amma, of course I understand it, Mone. Mone means son. My son, of course I understand. I know that land price. Then why did you wait for 7 years before buying the land? You know what is Amma's answer? Amma's answer was beautiful. Amma's answer was, Mone. Mone means son. Okay, my son. That guy, that is a person who owned the land. That guy, he's also my son. He has a sick wife. His wife's parents are living with him. His own parents are living with him. His sister is also living with him because of some personal problem he came back. He has two children. He has so many problems. Shouldn't he be given money offering so much? I was waiting so that he could get some nice amount of money. That's why. You need to applaud this. Here is a person who's waiting to get a loss. Waiting to get a loss. Incur a loss so that the other person can be helped more. Contrast it with that Bhuj engineer who ended up killing 400 people. Contrast these two value systems. That guy went to MIT. That guy is a civil engineering PhD. This, that, everything. For the sake of 5 crores, he killed 400 people. Amma went to 4th standard. Okay? But yet, look at the difference in the values. Look at the difference in the effect of society. That is what you need to know. So it is amazing, personally, for me, to come across a person who will cheat their own wives and husbands and kids. Nowadays, it's so pathetic. You don't, if you read the newspaper, it's horrible. The amount of bad news that hits you is so bad. So you know what I've done? I stopped reading newspapers. That's the only solution. I said, okay, very good. Make my day better. Don't read newspapers. Anyway, in this day and age, to come across a being so selfless, to be able to incur a loss so that the others can get. That is called a paradigm shift in thinking. And that is what I want to talk to you about today. See, go to the next slide. We are still on the first slide, remember? But I think I ended up telling you pretty much what I had to say. See, this is a very nice story. Where does this road go? Oh, this is coming in the way. Can you all see this slide? Yeah, you are. Some story. This guy was going on the road and he stops and asks a pedestrian, where does this road go? The pedestrian, the guy in the car asked the fellow on the road. The guy asked, where do you want to go? Then the driver said, I don't know where I'm going. Then the guy said, then it doesn't matter where the road goes, go. That is the present state of society. We don't know where we are going. We don't have a mission. We don't have a vision. We don't have values. We are just going. And where are we going? We have so-called advance in science and technology. Where have we gone? We have gone to poverty. We have gone to disease. We have gone to overpopulation. We have gone to terrorism. We have gone to fighting over every silly thing. We have gone to rape. We have gone to God knows what. Not only here, all over the world. 50 years ago, a survey was made of USA schools. Schools in USA, your most developed country on earth that you people think it is. 50 years ago, a survey was made of what are the problems faced by the average students and school systems in the US 50 years ago. You know what the problems were? Problems were students come in late, they make noise in class, they throw chalks. Very good. These are all very beautiful. If I have a class in which these are the only problems, I am very happy actually. That's a good class. You should make noise in class. Simply sitting quietly is... Hold on. But you should not disrespect anyone. You have fun, but clean fun. So 50 years ago, these are problems in the US school. People playing with chalks. Oh, it's a wonderful thing. Have you played with chalks? Yeah, I did too. But not in my class, okay? I won't allow it. Then don't tell them. The dean of Amrita is asking people to make noise in the class. It's really bad. No. But then, people are throwing chalks. They are coming late to class and they don't turn homework on time. This was the problems 50 years ago, which is natural and which is good actually. Yeah, you should have some fun. But today a survey was made 5 years ago about the problems in school in the US. You know what the problems are? What homework and all that? Gun violence, date rape, drug abuse, juvenile murder. This is in the most advanced country of the earth. The average problems in school. Where is coming late and throwing chalk? For me, those people are angels if they're only throwing chalk. Come, drug abuse. Yes. I have many friends in the US who are afraid to send their kids to school because I can't tell you the school districts because then if some relatives of yours are in US, they'll kill me. But yeah, it's true. It's true. In California, in Silicon Valley, where I live, next to Intel and Applied Materials and the most sophisticated technology on earth. Yeah, the school districts there. Not in Santa Clara or Cupertino, but other school districts. Drug abuse. They're afraid to send the children to school because other class kids are coming with guns and drugs. So I will do homeschooling. I will teach at home. So the wife stopped going to work. Only the husband goes to work because she wants to teach her kid at home because she's afraid to send the kid to school. This is a modern science and education. This is what happens when you forget dharma, if what happens when you forget values. That's the slide. Because you can read and understand yourself. Only when the last tree has died and the last river has been poisoned and the last fish has been caught, you will realize you can't eat money. If you ruin the whole world.
This is another nice story. You know, there was this Amma's story, by the way. There was this guy driving a truck. The truck carried fire extinguishers. Okay? The truck carried fire extinguishers. And the engine of the truck caught fire. See, he didn't know he was carrying fire extinguishers. Many truck drivers are there, they're just transporting the goods. So he jumped out of the truck, searched here and there in the neighborhood, called the police, this, that, found a fire extinguisher somewhere, came and last minute he put out the fire. After that, he opened the truck and found that he was himself carrying fire extinguishers. What is the meaning of this story? You have the solution within yourself. Applaud her. You don't need a PhD to do this. You have the solution. What's your name? Abhiram. From where? Abhiram Sundari. Wow, beautiful name. From where? From Coimbatore. Abhiram Sundari. Very good. Beautiful name. It means beautiful. Sundari is beautiful. Abhiram is beautiful. You are doubly beautiful. Your answer is beautiful. Good. Yeah. You have the solution within yourself. And that's what we need to know. We need to have what is called a paradigm shift in our thinking. You know what's a paradigm shift? What is a paradigm shift in thinking? What do you see? What do you see there? Of course, who is the person here on this side? Exactly. What is Einstein? He was the world's most brilliant scientist, the most brilliant guy. Before me, of course. I was not there then. Yeah, that's a joke. You have to laugh, okay? So, he was the world's most. That's Einstein. That's, of course, Amma. What do you see there? You see a rabbit. Okay. How many of you see a rabbit? How many of you see a duck? How many of you see both? That's what I mean by a paradigm shift. Paradigm shift is a change in thinking. On one way you see a duck. Quack, 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 quack. The other way you see a rabbit. I deliberately put these two pictures here. Can anybody tell me in a slide on paradigm shift in thinking, why I put these two people's pictures here? One side is Einstein and one side is Amma. Can anybody tell me why I put these two people's pictures in a slide on paradigm shift? Please tell me. Abhiram, Abhiram Sundari, try. Actually,
education is
turn the volume on.
Hello.
Speak into the mic, yeah.
Education is both spiritual and scientific learning.
Wow! Good! Education is both spirituality and science. Anything else? Any other reason? Yes, our Akash, tell me. Come here. Come here, decisive strategy maker. Come here. Come running fast. I need to give you high five. Fast? What, young fellow? High five. Tell them what you just said.
Both people have been responsible for humongous changes in the world.
What changes?
Einstein is the one who actually drafted the equation which directly is responsible for the nuclear weapons. E equal to MC square. And Amma is directly responsible for many people being consoled from their sorrows.
Actually, he said, he wanted, the guy in orange also wanted to say something. What's your name? What's your name? Sabari, yeah, Sabari, you're from? Akash, you're from which place? Coimbatore. And you?
I'm from Bangalore campus.
Okay. What happened to all my North Indian friends? Coimbatore is talking, Bangalore is talking. Arre, I want to hear Himachal Pradesh and Ranchi and Uttarakhand and Jharkhand and our athlete is keeping quiet. Okay, tell me, Coimbatore. Oh, Bangalore.
Amma is the one who not studied nothing and changed the world. And Albert Einstein is the one who studied everything and changed the world.
Actually, not fully true. Einstein also, you know, when he was a kid, the teacher said the fellows. Okay. Useless in this and that.
But she studied until only fourth class, which doesn't mean anything.
Yeah. So by my next slide, I'm going to tell you Why? That is very important. You know what Mark Twain said? Hey, I forgot your name. What's your name? Shabrish. You know what Mark, you know Mark Twain? Have you read Tom Sawyer, Huckleberry Finn? Yeah. You know what Mark Twain said about education and schooling? He said, and I quote, he said, "I never let my schooling interfere with my education." Do you understand that? I never let my schooling interfere with, I'm going to tell you why very soon. Savarish, yes, thank you. So one was Amma and Einstein have changed the world. Abhirami was spirituality and science, and he said, Amma has not studied anything, but yet so much Einstein studied everything. Any other answers? Yes. Tell me. Your name I forgot. I never asked it. Sorry. Akshita.
As per my view, most of the people considered Einstein as a mad person. But he was the one who made everyone mad. And for Amma, as you said that she studied, had a schooling till class 4. No, no.
I am telling you the truth.
Yeah.
Yes. You didn't know that, yes. There were many people in the village when Amma started. You know the way Amma gives darshan, she meets each and every person, hugs each one, does not, she sits for 24 hours at a stretch, does not get up till she meets the last person. She used to hug in case, so in this village, they belong to the so-called lowest caste or whatever. So there were some untouchables, and they were not supposed to go and touch them, but she used to go and hug them and kiss them and, you know, bathe the old people, give them food. She used to stop eating and steal her own food without telling her parents and go and give it to them. She gave them her bangles, etc., etc. She got beaten for it. Many villagers thought she was mad. She used to spend night and day, you know, crying to God and crying for these people. And people thought her mad too. Yes, but both of them had a paradigm shift in thinking. Both of them had a courage to be different. And both of them did not subscribe to conventions of society. And both of them were criticized tremendously by others. But still, they stuck to what they thought was right. And that's why they are leaders.